Anybody want water? Everybody ready? Let's go.
Are you ready?
Wait on you, baby.
Three 357 Productions is proud to present The Masonian, a monthly podcast for Freemasons with a focus on the Grand Jurisdiction of North Carolina. While not an official function of the Grand Lodge of North Carolina, we operate with the full endorsement of Grand Master Douglas Cottle. The opinions expressed on the show are those of the participants and in no way reflect the opinions of the Grand Lodge of North Carolina, its members, or any appendant bodies.
Right.
And although Grand Master Marshal Shaun Bradshaw does not like our intro music, he would prefer trap music. We don't own this music, but as always, we sure do like it.
Right.
I want to correct the record. I do like Metallica.
Trap Good. Version. House Good. Version.
The house version. No, I do like Metallica.
We are fortunate to have Grand Marshal Shaun Bradshaw, who is a member of Stokesdale Lodge number 428, was awarded his 33rd degree in 2009 and is past Venerable Master, and is also officers in Greensboro York Rite Bodies.
And a whole bunch of other stuff.
Yes, a huge list, laundry list.
But it was like really, really long, and it was going to take like the whole hour just to tell all the things that Shaun actually is. So we decided we held him down and forced him to that two or three things.
Just three, yeah.
What is a Grand Marshal? What does a Grand Marshal even do?
The Grand Marshal escorts the guests and other officers as requested or directed by the Grand Master. It's actually kind of a neat position in the Grand Lodge line, because you're the only person who doesn't know your part until the day of Grand Lodge. You never know exactly who you're introducing until practically the last minute.
Well, there's no, like, are there any, like, hard names, hard to pronounce? Have you ever messed one up?
Well, I got really lucky this year. My list was pretty straightforward. I had the easiest. I think Mac had a few choice ones last year when he was Grand Marshal. But no, I lucked out this year. Mine were all pretty easy. The only little hiccup was when our Prince Hall brethren came and DT showed up, who of course was a guest on your show. I had been told that he might come. And so I was sort of prepared for that, but I neglected to capture his title. So when I went to introduce him, I had to kind of look at his badge to get his title. And there were a couple other guys that showed up too, but they didn't ask to be introduced. So I got out easy on that one.
They're good guys, man. I love all them guys. DT called me today. I didn't call him back.
Better call the man back.
Better call the man back tomorrow. T, our man.
He's some a ideas, man. I'm sure.
Well, you know, when he was here last time, he floated the idea of us having a joint Grand Lodge building where we could both Grand East in the same building.
The Grand East, yeah.
We were all for it. He was all for it, but you know, he said that might cause him some grief. So
they've got a nice little place at in Durham, though. It looks good.
Yeah, I've never been there.
Yeah. I've never been inside, but the outside's pretty cool.
All right, so this Grand Marshal thing, this is a line officer's position?
That's right.
So next year you'll be the...
Bryant Webster, our current Deputy Grand Master and Grand Master-elect, did appoint me to Grand Junior Deacon. So Junior Deacon will be the next step.
And you guys have an installation coming up soon.
That's right. Installation first Saturday in December.
In Asheville.
Open to the public.
Of course. Open to the public.
If you've never been to a Grand installation, you ought to go. This is going to be especially cool because I love that building up there. I love that Mount Hermon building. It is one of the treasures of North Carolina, and I'm so glad that he's going to be installed up there. I can't wait. And, you know, then we're going to the Biltmore House while we're there, and hopefully it's going to snow because it's going to be, you know, December in Asheville.
Shout out to my daughter for her birthdays in December. We're actually doing the candlelight tour with her and a friend of hers after installation. Yeah, later that evening.
I mean, maybe not we all, but we'll be there. Probably all the same.
We'll be
there. There's a
wave as we're going by. Yeah.
Yeah.
parade way. All right, so Shaun, tell us how you got into masonry. I've heard you tell this story before, but it's pretty interesting.
How I got into masonry, it goes way back. So I'm certain most members of the fraternity have recollections of running into the fraternity or people who were members of the fraternity throughout their life, and that sort of happened to me as well. You know, didn't really know that much about it, but I won't go into all the details, but the long and short of it was, I was a young married guy, newborn son, grew up with my grandmother and my mother, so I really didn't have a father figure in the house. And you know, what dawned on me is I got this little boy, and I don't have a father figure myself. How am I going to be a dad to this kid? And I don't know what a dad's supposed to do. And I thought, I need to surround myself with other guys, good role models that I can hopefully use as examples to help me raise my child. And so through a set of unusual circumstances, we'll call them, I came to learn about the fraternity in depth. Like I said, had been running into it all along the way, but wasn't real familiar with it, and made that first step of asking someone. It turned out to be my college roommate's father, Ted Wright. My college roommate was Chris Wright. Some people who listen to this podcast will know Chris, a very well known Mason. And Ted, when I asked him about Freemasonry, his eyes lit up, and he talked for almost an hour about it. And I knew that's as much as he's going into it. That's something I got to get into. So that's how I ended up kind of getting into it.
And what lodge did you join?
Stokesdale 428. Yep. That's why I joined Stokesdale. I live in Greensboro, but I joined Stokesdale because Ted was a member in Stokesdale. And it's not that much further for me to go out there.
So Stokesdale is one of those lodges that has a lot of people that have been really active in Masonry.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny how you hit these little lodges around, right? Blackmer's kind of like that. We're just a little country lodge, but we've got a lot of guys that are like really involved. I just wonder, do you think that happens because you get a circle of guys and they're like picking guys to do other active things in Masonry from the, you know, the pool that they know that are close to home and the guys that they can trust? Or do you think there's just something to the fact that there's little pockets of guys that would make really active Masons and they just kind of bubble to the top in different geographic areas?
Well, there's an esoteric answer, which I'll leave for later. but I think what happens, or the tendency, is when you have an active lodge and you have that core of active members, there's an excitement and a passion about the fraternity that is contagious. And so the new members who come in, who will have an inclination towards that, naturally pick up on that passion. And so you gain additional leaders, additional ritualists, additional active members as a result.
Yeah, Statesville's like that too. It's another one that's just...
Yes, Statesville's
another one. So just do a little shout out to the home team. Tell us some of the folks that have been in Stokesdale that people listening to the broadcast around the state would recognize.
Well, the big name, of course, is Bill Simpson, who is a past Grand Master, past Grand Worthy Patron, and past Grand Commander of the Knights Templar in North Carolina. So in all reality, as many past Grands as you can be in North Carolina. Of course, he passed away just a little over a year ago. Sad to see him. But he was a solid foundation in Stokesdale. And that's the one I think most everyone in North Carolina would know. In Stokesdale and in the 23rd District, of course, Chris Wright, I've already mentioned. He's a two-time master of Stokesdale Lodge, a certified lecturer, does a great degree work. A lot of people know him. A little bit less well-known, unless you're in the Stokesdale area, would be Ray Comer, of course. Ray was one of the signers on my petition. I'll never forget sitting down at his kitchen table and meeting this guy and him talking to me about what we were going through and all that. That was fantastic. And quick shout out to, and he'll never see this, Clyde Howerton. Every lodge seems to have the ritualist, the guy who's like the stickler for exactly how you do everything.
Yeah.
And Clyde, for Chris and I, as we came through together, Clyde was that guy. But he was a gentle soul in that he never had to raise his voice. You always knew if you were doing it right with him, and if you didn't do it right, he showed you how to do it, or he told you how to do it. It was never forceful in any way. You just wanted to do it right because Clyde was there, and he would make the suggestion on how you do it or change it or what have you. Of course, Ray and Bill Simpson were the same. That's what I might kind of refer to as the old guard of Stokesdale when Chris and I joined. Of course, there's a lot of great members out there who are coming up behind them and helping us. We've done a lot of great things. Frank, our most immediate past master, did a lot of great things at the lodge. So we've got a good team out there. I enjoy my time at Stokesdale.
Real good. We'll talk about that deeper meaning later. By the way, we don't use that E word here in North Carolina. We use the word philosophical.
Well, you can use whatever you want on this podcast.
We don't want to scare nobody. It is almost Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
So we're wanting the focus for this podcast to be the Scottish Rite.
Right.
And so originally, just so everybody knows, we had James Howell scheduled for this time slot. We were going to talk about York Rite.
He's the illustrious Grand Master of the Royal and Select Masters.
So he's like the Grand Master of the York Rite in North Carolina,
One of the three bodies, right?
So James couldn't be with us tonight. He had some conflicts, and so we're going to swap he and you. And so Sean could come at a last minute's notice. He was able to come down here. So we're going to talk about Scottish. We'll do York Rite next month. Want to talk about both of those bodies? They're both hugely important. Love them a ton. But to get on with the Scottish Rite, tell us how you got into Scottish Rite Masonry.
It just like probably anybody else, you get in, you hear about these other things, and someone comes up to you with a petition, and Ray Comer was the guy with the petition for me. Through my, earlier I mentioned bumping into Freemasonry along the way, one of the things I bumped into was Morals and Dogma when I was a teenager. It was someone else's copy. I just happened to see it in their library, and that kind of looks neat. Let me, look into it at some point in time, and eventually I did. Scottish Rite piqued my interest because of the philosophical aspects to it. When people ask me, should I join York Rite? Should I join Scottish Rite? I hedge giving them advice to go one way or the other, especially, one or the other. I suggest you do both. York Rite, in what I typically tell them, York Rite follows the same storyline as the Blue Lodge, and is sort of as historical as is probably the best way I can put it, is more historical in nature. You get some gaps filled in. Whereas Scottish Rite's much more philosophical. It kind of goes off, it's a different storyline. It's the same story, but a different way of telling it. And then you go into all these other areas of philosophy, which, at first glance don't seem to have anything to do with what we do in the Blue Lodge. But on further, inspection and contemplation, you realize, wait a minute, every bit of this is there. You just got to look.
Yeah. Love that. So what is Scottish Rite? Where did it come from? Did it come from Scotland?
Misnomer. Scottish Rite is not Scottish, it's French. And apparently the French, the guys who started putting together these high degrees, the haute grades, they decided to, I guess, apply some level of additional mystery to what they were doing, and they called it the Écossais. I'm probably mispronouncing that, but Scottish is essentially what it meant. But it's not Scottish.
So, like, French Freemasonry really took off and went in a thousand different directions, didn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it really splintered out into a bunch of different stuff. And one of them was Scottish Rite, which migrated to America and has been here for a very long time. But my understanding is that, it was kind of here and it was kind of here and kind of here. And then after the Civil War, Pike really took it, revised the ritual, and turned it into what... that was the beginning of turning it in, into what we know today. Is that correct?
That's correct. We don't want to go in too much detail on the history. The Scottish Rite wasn't originally called the Scottish Rite, of course, but the degrees associated with the Scottish Rite migrated through the West Indies, up through Louisiana, into the rest of North America, settled in Charleston, where, of course, the Mother Supreme Council was established, and it was rather dormant. I mean, like you said, in the original Scottish Rite formation, degrees were just communicated, not unlike how we do some of our degrees today. They were simply read. Now, then you would have the whole degree read to you, which was quite extensive. Of course, along came Albert Mackey, who saw some promise in this guy named Albert Pike and all that he was doing in other parts of Freemasonry, and said that he needs to be a part of what we're into here, and got him in on it. And Pike just saw something there. He saw a rough stone and thought it just needed some polishing. And so, of course, what we do today is heavily influenced by what Pike put together in those mid to late 1800s.
And from what I understand, and you're the expert here, so you correct me where I go wrong, but from what I understand, when in Pike's time, at the time that he revised them, you didn't go get all 29 degrees in a weekend like you do now. It's more like the European system, what you see in Great Britain now, where those degrees come very slowly and they're very cherished and very difficult to obtain and take a lot of work and time.
When Pike was made a Scottish Rite Mason, it was not the kind of thing where he got it all at once, but it certainly wasn't as slow as what we see in Europe. Again, they were communicated, the degrees were not performed, but it was kind of like just a continuous process, but in a fairly short time frame. What he did was he helped put some drama to it. Although he never saw them performed in dramatic fashion, he expanded some of the aspects of the degrees so that they could be done in dramatic form. And of course, one of the things that some people probably do know about Pike from his work, you know, Morals and Dogmas, Pike had this idea that somewhere in our ancient history there was a religion. There was a single thought around our presence and with deity. And he was constantly in search for how far back can I go? And one of the central themes of the Scottish Rite degrees that you can, if you pay attention, you'll see his fingerprints all over, is he's constantly trying to get us back to what was the common theme or philosophy to all religions, and what's that central point? Now, historically, he may not have been correct there, but of course, that was what he was working off of.
So that's certainly a school of thought that's been around for a long time, and you're saying he was an ardent student of it, and put all of that into our degrees. Very interesting. We're going to talk a lot more about Pike later. We thought that we would first sprint through some of the breakdown, some of the structure, and how this looks. So how originally this started in Charleston. Mackey and Pike were both in Charleston when they were reworking the degrees.
The original Mother Supreme Council was in Charleston. Of course, Mackey and Pike were in Arkansas at the time. But I
did not know that.
Yeah.
Both of them?
Well, Pike was from Arkansas, Little Rock, and I'm not sure where Mackey was from, but they knew each other, so I suppose that given travel at the time, that Mackey would have had to be in that area at some point too. So the Charleston is
should be taking notes here.
Charleston is an earlier sort of part of the Scottish Rite history.
And at some point, now the House of the Temple is in D.C., and it's run out of D.C., at least the southern jurisdiction.
Right. And that was Pike's doing.
So how did that happen? Yeah. And then at the same time, feed into this whole lot, the northern jurisdiction and the southern jurisdiction, and how all that got split up?
Well, the northern and southern jurisdiction, I don't want to create any kind of issues here. but
from a historical perspective.
When the Mother Supreme Council was formed, it was done off of basically papers that designated that there could be two Supreme Councils in North America.
I wonder why. Oh, I know why.
And so they decided to create one. It just did not exist at that time, not formally. We won't get into the history of what everything that took place in Louisiana. That's for another show, maybe more detailed than we want to get into. But in doing that, there were, of course, some spurious Scottish Rite individuals who tried to kick off and really sail degrees is what they were doing. And I won't go into all the details, but in the northern jurisdiction, they felt the need to sort of formalize themselves as well, and that's the upper 13 states. I believe that's correct, or maybe 15. But anyway, so basically the southern jurisdiction was everything else and has continued to be everything else in the United States as we, the United States, expanded. But the Albert Pike actually was the one who moved the southern jurisdiction to be based in Washington, D.C. I'm sure somewhere along the way I've read why, but I don't recall now.
It's funny, since he was, of course, we know that he was a Confederate general and apparently a son of the South, and this would have been after the war, probably way after the war.
It was.
Well, I guess it would have been after he revised the degrees, so it probably would have been in, like, what, the 1880s?
Yeah, around in the 1880s, and he actually revised the degrees a couple of times. So he was part of a small committee that was put together to do an initial revision of the degrees, to clean them up. There were lots of slight different versions here and there being worked, and the Supreme Council said, you know, we need to kind of get our arms around this. Let's have a committee. Well, Pike's the only one who actually did any work, and he literally hand wrote all the degrees, and it's come to be known as the magnum opus, his great work. But those are not the degrees we work. They continue to go through further revision, and the most recent revision was put out by the Supreme Council, I think, in 2004. I may be a little bit off on the dates, but I think it was around 2004. And it's what we refer to as the Standard Pike Revision. And the idea there was very similar to Pike's time. Over time, different valleys, different orients have their little flavors of how they are going to present the degrees. And the Supreme Council knew this was happening, but they said, you know what, the degrees are quite long. Everybody's making these revisions to try to shorten them up. We're trying to get everything in. People want to see the degrees, but we don't have weeks on end. The men don't have as much, well, I shouldn't say they don't, but we don't take as much leisure time to study this stuff and to participate in the degree work. So what can we do to help that and to get to the central idea? So a couple of the great scholars were put together. If I remember correctly, Dr. Brunk, who is our Sovereign Grand Inspector General, had a hand in
What's the Sovereign Grand Inspector General?
He is the SGIG, the Sovereign Grand Inspector General, is the head, and he is sovereign in whatever jurisdiction he covers, which for Dr. Brunk is the Orient of North Carolina, which consists of the entire state of North Carolina.
So there are 50 of those.
There's more, because you actually have SGIGs outside of the we'll get into some technicalities, but there's jurisdictions outside of North America that also kind of go into the Supreme Council, but actually there's not that many SGIGs. There are similar people who control Scottish Rite within their states. Some are called SGIGs, depending on whether or not they're actually active members of the Supreme Council, and some are considered deputies.
Okay, that sounds complicated.
It
retract
can
my question.
And I may have all this, you know, completely off myself, but that's the best.
Hey, you got us. We're sounds good to us.
Sold.
Yeah.
So the northern jurisdiction, where we have the House of the Temple, they apparently have one of those. They have a.
If I remember correctly, I think it's in Lexington, Massachusetts. I'm pretty sure that's right.
And I know very little about their degrees, but everybody that I hear that is a northern jurisdiction guy gripes and complains about their degrees. Apparently, they are have been changed very, very much from ours are changed.
Right.
Theirs are really, really changed.
Yes. Now I'm gonna speak based on what I have read, not what I have observed. So I may be speaking out of turn, but from what I have read, when you get to a certain point in the degrees, we take a turn towards the rebuilding of the temple, and with Zerubbabel and all those guys. They move into a different segment of history to tell a similar story, and they use the American Revolution as the basis of their storyline.
That's different.
So it's interesting, and you know, if I were to guess, which I will, you know, it probably has to do with where they're located. You know, there was a hotbed of activity there, and so there's a lot of pride in all the things and the philosophies and ideas that were generated at that time, and so they use that to help tell the story. And in the end, that's probably what counts more is telling the story.
Oh yeah, sure it does. I would love to see those degrees though.
It'd be great.
I'd like to see how they put those together with the American Revolution.
Mm-hmm.
Huh. When DT was here, he told us that the Prince Hall guys, their grandmother administration building is in, did he say Memphis? Somewhere in Tennessee, either Nashville or I think it was Memphis.
That sounds right.
So we were asking if our degrees are similar to theirs, and he didn't want to talk about it much, and of course this wasn't the venue to do that probably, but I'm just curious if we have not only visitation with those guys, you know, and recognition, do we with the Scottish Rite also?
Mm-hmm.
I think the answer I keep getting is yes, but I don't know anybody that's been to the Prince Hall Scottish Rite degrees, and
right.
I don't remember any of them coming to ours, but I think that might be a good idea.
It might be. I can tell you this. I know at the time that the Standard Pike revisions were made, copies of those revisions were given to our Prince Hall counterparts. So whether or not they've implemented them in the same way, I can't speak to, but they do have the same versions of the rituals that we have.
So if a guy wants in North Carolina wants to join the Scottish Rite, he's a Blue Lodge Mason,
mm-hmm.
he's raised Master Mason, and he wants to join, how does he go about doing that?
Well, you know, depending on the lodge, he probably gets raised and gets asked immediately.
Right.
Some of the we know we have
stick.
A particular brother in Greensboro that I, you know, he's there with the petition. Steve Lynch, of course, whom we all love, but you know, it's as simple as asking. I'm sure all lodges have some member of the Scottish Rite. We do what we call reunions, which is when members are made twice a year. All the valleys in North Carolina, with the exception of two, we'll get into what all the valleys are. But by my understanding, with the exception of two of the valleys, all of them do reunions twice a year. And there's a reason why the other two don't probably follow the same schedule. But again, we can get into that a little bit later. So fall and spring, be on the lookout, and there will be some Scottish Rite work in a valley near you.
And you can do that in one weekend?
Typically, most of the valleys do it in one weekend. Occasionally, and I don't want to speak out of turn again, but my understanding is that I believe Raleigh spreads theirs over a couple of weekends, but that may have been a one-time deal. It may not be something they do all the time.
So let's talk about North Carolina and how it's structured since we brought it up. Tell us how it's broken down and where a guy would go.
Sure. So in North Carolina, which every Masonic organization has its own nomenclature, in North Carolina, the state is referred to as an Orient, and then each subordinate body is referred to as a valley. So if I start on the East Coast, we have the Valley of Wilmington and then New Bern. There is one of the two that's a little different called Enfield, which is up near Halifax. And the reason that one's a little bit different is it's only up through the 14th degree. It's only the Lodge of Perfection. From there, continuing to move westward, we get to Raleigh. And then, of course, Greensboro and Winston-Salem. Shout out to the Winston-Salem brothers. We just did some degree work, some reunion work with them, and we've been thrilled to have them and help host them while they're waiting on their new building to be completed. Once you get a little bit further west, you hit Charlotte, and then finally Asheville is the last full one. But we have a brand new Lodge of Perfection in Franklin, North Carolina. So this is a little bit different. There are also clubs, some local clubs, just like in the Shrine, can have local Shrine clubs. But the Lodge of Perfection can actually do that degree work. So you have that in Franklin and Enfield. And again, I'm not familiar with what, if any, degree work they do and or how they schedule it. But Franklin's very new, just chartered last year.
Really? Are they meeting in a Blue Lodge?
I believe they meet in a lodge in Franklin, but I haven't been there, so I don't know for sure.
Where is Franklin? That must be way west.
It's way west, yeah.
I see.
And that's, you know, part of the reason is you've got, you know, you don't want to leave guys out just because it's difficult to get to your meetings in Asheville, and so that was part of the impetus of doing that. And that's not a totally new phenomenon. We see other new valleys popping up here and there to accommodate the brethren who want to have regular degree work or get together and do Scottish Rite, but maybe not full-blown.
So two of my very favorite buildings in North Carolina have a history with the Scottish Rite. One of them is in Greensboro, mm-hmm. of course, and we're still there. The other one is, of course, Asheville, and I understand the Scottish Rite is no longer meeting in that building, but for many, many years they did.
Yes.
And then there were other buildings, of course, all over the state where Scottish Rite had buildings that they were either moving out of or have very recently moved out of or are going to move out of. And I just hear a lot of chatter about Scottish Rite moving out of some of their historic mm-hmm. old buildings, and I hate to see it. I'm so glad that in Greensboro, you know, when I came along, there was a lot of talk about maybe leaving that building. And I just hated to see that happen, and I wasn't part of any kind of leadership at that point, but somehow cooler heads prevailed, and we lucked out, and whatever was going on then got worked out, and we're now still mm-hmm. in that building, and my understanding is it's our intent to stay there for a very long time.
It is our
intent.
Which
I love, because that is a beautiful, historic building. You know, the one in Asheville, I don't know. I keep hearing rumors that they may get back together at some point, and I really hope they do. I'd love to see these buildings preserved, but what in the world is going on with all these Scottish Rite selling their buildings? Winston sold theirs. I understand that was probably they just got offered so much money they couldn't
turn
it down. But I heard rumors that Charlotte's going to move out and they're going to move out in New Bern and the crowd in Wilmington might move out of their building.
It's financial. What it boils down to is, you know, for a variety of reasons, the Scottish Rite benefited from what we would probably now refer to as a bubble in membership. Of course, the individual lodges benefited to some degree, but of course, new lodges were popping up along the way. The Scottish Rite really benefited in that you had a limited number of valleys available, so, you know, hundreds of members were pouring in, and so it was financially feasible to have a building that was occupied a few times a month and could, you know, be supported by all these people and had facilities for hundreds of people. As the membership has shrunk, of course, that need goes down, but along with the need is also the finances. And in Greensboro, I will say, quite lucky on a variety of fronts, not least of which is having a couple of guys who are local lodge members and members of our Scottish Rite Valley who are quite active in keeping that building, you know, running well and doing it as volunteers. I mean, it would be quite expensive to have to
give them a shout out.
That would be Greg Woolard and
Gene. Gotcha.
Yeah, Gene Godsoe. Thank you. Put me on the spot there.
Well, I didn't mean to trip you up there, but I think they deserve a shout. Anybody deserves a shout out, they do, because they have personally transformed that building into something special.
And it's a beautiful building. The other thing with Greensboro that's a little bit unique is because there are other organizations that meet there, several, I think there's seven lodges. Of course, the York Rite, Greensboro York Rite meets there. That adds to some of the stability in terms of the finances. The burden can be spread across several different organizations.
if everybody can just get along.
Yeah, and we're getting along now, so that's the good thing. And that's a lot of that's Dan Rice too, past Grandmaster Dan Rice, who heads up the Masonic Temple Board.
We got to get him on here sometime. We'll go. We'll go shoot him in Lynch Lodge.
There you go.
We'll go on the road. Cool. Yeah. I bet he can do that. Well, so you know, I don't know. I'm just really happy at Greensboro that worked out. And I hate to see these guys move out of their buildings, but, you know, finances are what they are. What will they do? Go to a Blue Lodge somewhere? Winston built a building, but they got a bunch of money.
Yeah.
Or building a building.
My understanding is the building is almost complete. We've heard that before. If I understand correctly, it could be as early as December, but they're targeting January for grand opening. Of course, Asheville, when they left the Asheville building, they went into a regular lodge setting. New Bern has gone in with the local York Rite group. They have a building. Wilmington is still in theirs, and Charlotte is in theirs for now. Charlotte is looking at opportunities, and Gilbert Bailey, who's their new personal rep, and just to, some more nomenclature, a personal representative is the eyes and ears of the Sovereign Grand Inspector General in the Valley, so reports directly to Dr. Bronk on matters concerning the Valley. But Gilbert's their new personal rep, and from conversations with him, you know, they have sort of an idea of wanting to sell their building, and then go into something smaller, and then maybe do reunions at different facilities. Yeah, where they don't have to support a huge facility on a shrinking membership.
Right. I'm trying to decide if I want to talk about, you know, the degrees in the building some more, if I just want to go right to Gilbert. Don't let me forget to circle back to Gilbert.
We can talk about Gilbert at some point, but yeah.
I couldn't imagine having grown up in the Scottish Rite at Greensboro, mm-hmm. in that magnificent building, and you know, the prep room and the behind the stage and just all those places that are so familiar and special and so big, and the drops.
The lighting.
You know, I couldn't imagine going and doing those degrees in like just a Blue Lodge setting, or even in like a hotel room, or, you know, a rental space somewhere.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it just, the character of that building lends so much emotion to the degrees that I couldn't imagine it without it.
True.
There's an energy in that building.
There is an energy in that building. I have visited the other valleys. New Bern, I've always liked the feeling of New Bern, the way it was designed, and the ambiance, if you will, the lighting, the sounds, the everything about it is just, it adds to the experience of watching these dramas. If you remember, this is kind of how Pike designed them. He wanted them to. He didn't see it himself, but he imagined a time when the degrees would be portrayed in dramatic form and be a theatrical production. And so you needed a theater. And sure enough, the Scottish Rite members made that happen. We made it a reality. It is sad to see that we're having to move away from that in some areas.
If Pike never saw them, I wonder when they started doing them in a theatrical setting.
It's a good question. I'd have to go back to some of my references. I'm not sure.
Maybe he's watching them after all.
Well, probably so.
So who appointed Gilbert Bailey?
Well, that, of course,
is that Dr. Bronk?
Dr. Bronk, the Sovereign Grid Inspector General, appoints two officers. Well, yeah, I'll call them two officers in each valley, the personal rep and the secretary. The secretary is an appointed officer in the valley. So Gilbert was appointed, I believe, in August to that position.
Well, I don't think Dr. Brunt could have made a better choice. I you know, Gilbert is way up here. Hope he's listening. Gilbert, if you're listening, man, we love you a ton. He is so deep. He's so interesting to talk to. He's just a galvanizing figure. He's going to be so good for that valley.
I believe so too.
And he's young, and he, mm-hmm. and he's, you know, enthusiastic, and he would be right for any valley. But I'm really, really happy for him and the guys in Charlotte. I know that was a great choice, and you know, since we're throwing names out, I think we've got to say something about Gene Cobb. He has pulled us all together in Greensboro in a really wonderful way. Go ahead and expand. I love him so much.
I would refer to Gene as a unifier. Certainly, I suspect his vocation as a Methodist minister helps with that. He has some experience in bringing people together. He is fond of saying, you know, you do everything in love. I mean, and you feel it when you're around him. He exudes that idea. And so we are blessed in Greensboro to have Gene leading us now, not to diminish any of the work done by any of the prior personal reps, but he was the right person at the right time to get us to where we needed to be.
And he involves a lot of people in the decision-making process, and that gives everybody buy-in.
That's true. And you know, that wasn't always the case, although that's a little hearsay. When I joined, Bill Simpson was the Secretary of the Valley, a brother by the name of Lee Rumley. You guys probably don't know Lee or did not know Lee. He was the personal rep at the time. But they were quite inclusive, in my opinion, coming in. When I joined, our class wanted to put on a degree, and they were like, "Oh yeah, let's do that." In fact, here's a degree, the eighth degree in 10 of the building. And you don't like the E word, so I'll say, from a philosophical perspective, I think there was something to that that's deeper than I have often or even realized at the time. But we'll talk about that later too. Can I talk about Gilbert real quick?
Oh, absolutely. Please do. Yes.
So I've had a long and very good relationship with Gilbert. The Scottish Rite supports charities here in North Carolina. Our primary charity is the North Carolina Scottish Rite Masonic Foundation, which actually is set up to support language and learning disorder clinics at Appalachian State and ECU, and we have a telemedicine clinic in Swan Quarter, which is about as far east as you can go. And my first interaction with Gilbert was on a Orient-wide committee to help support this charity. Past Grand Master Dewey Pressler, who was the person who appointed me to the Grand Line, was the chairman of that committee. I'll probably say I was kind of his right-hand man. And then we had this guy, Gilbert, down in Charlotte, who was popping in every once in a while as we were getting things going. And he was just quite impressive with the ideas he brought to the table and quite passionate about what we were doing. So through the efforts of Dewey and Gilbert and the other members of the committee, you know, over the last 5 years, going on six now, we've been able to raise over $250,000 in turnover, over about $120,000, $130,000 to the charities. So, you know, that's just a statement about how good that committee was in general, but particularly the leadership of people like Dewey and Gilbert.
Super cool for Gilbert. Riley, got anything you want to say? We've been hogging up the conversation.
Just taking it all in, man.
Before we leave the structure, I want to say something about General Wilkerson and his role with him.
Well, Lloyd, General Wilkerson, was the Sovereign Grand Inspector General when I joined. And one of the interesting things I'll never forget, and I hope he sees this, that just impressed me to no end, was it is tradition that the SGIG will visit the Valley during your reunion. And of course, you make a big to-do about the SGIG coming in, and we did. And of course, he's given the gavel, and you expect, you know, General, he's going to stand there and he's going to command the troops. And he was just, he wasn't what you would expect from a Marine Corps general, let me put it that way. Just, very easygoing. But one of the things he said was, you know, as I go around, people are always trying to give me little trinkets and gifts. He said, I've always told people, don't do that. Give that money to the charities. And so from that, you knew what was first on his mind.
Yeah.
It was never about him. It was about the work we were doing.
If you're watching this on 357productions.net, and if you're watching it, that's where you're watching it at. We have an interview with the general that we shot maybe a year and a half ago, Sean. It's an hour-long interview, and Speed did the interview, and for probably 10 or 15 minutes of it, he talks about the Scottish Rite and his time as SGIG. So when you get done watching this, hop over there and watch the general's interview, and you can hear what he has to say about his time when he was SGIG in North Carolina. Got that. I can't read my own writing, so I really don't know what that says. House of the Temple. Tell us just a little bit about the House of the Temple. I've never been there.
You have not.
No,
we
have not.
Have got
I've been to D.C. twice. It was on my must-do list both times. Didn't make it either time.
That's a shame. Every Mason needs to go to the House of the Temple. It is an impressive structure. It's a beautiful building. I'm going to get this wrong, but it's modeled after one of the seven wonders of the world.
Mausoleum.
The mausoleum, yeah. And just gorgeous from one end to the other. When you walk into the temple room, it's, I don't know how tall the ceilings are, 30, 40 feet high. I mean, it's, as you can tell, I talk a lot and I'm I'm losing my words over this because it's hard to describe. You have to go to get the feeling for it. Whether you're a Scottish Rite member or not, you need to go. Similar to every other building, though, you know, there's a financial cost to maintaining a building like that, especially in Washington, D.C. And there is an effort going on right now to it's called rebuilding the temple. And there are a lot of activities around trying to raise the funds to make sure we still have that building for another 100-plus years.
Well, sooner or later, I'm going to make it there.
You need to go. You just need to get on the bike or get in a camper or whatever you're going to travel in. Horse, I don't know how you go. And get up there and just make a day of it. They will be happy to give you a tour.
When we go to Rolling Thunder next year, Brown, we're going to the House of the Temple.
It's a plan.
Come hell or high water, we're going to make it there.
I'm on it.
All right, so we've been messing around talking about the system and the people and all for about 45 minutes now. Let's get to the good stuff. Let's talk about the degrees. Mm-hmm. And what they mean to us. How are they broken down? I understand they're broken into four sections. Tell us about it.
Right. So the Scottish Rite itself is divided into four different bodies. You have the Lodge of Perfection, which is over the 4th through the 14th degree. Then you have the Chapter of Rosecroix, which is over the 15th, 16th, 17th, and 18th degrees. You have the Council of Kadosh, which takes 19 through 30, and then the Consistory, which has 31, 32, and 33. Of course, in a reunion, we portray as many of the degrees as we can. We would do more if we had people to do them, willing to take the parts and things like that. Of course, a little bit around the time. But currently, in Greensboro at least, we're doing about 10 or 11 of the degrees regularly. Some valleys do more, some do less. The Lodge of Perfection, the 4th through the 14th degree, is... I mentioned earlier about the storyline. You know, all the Masons know the storyline of the third degree. And it's a familiar storyline, but it's not the same storyline. Things are a little bit different, but it's okay. I mean, you catch on pretty quick to what's going on or what has happened. And one of the things I like about the Scottish Rite up through the 14th degree is... The way it's done, it brings in a few extra... I'm having a hard time talking about it because I don't want to reveal anything that's
right.
out in the public. But it pulls in some aspects that you don't think about when you're in the Blue Lodge, but once you see it and you start to think about it, it's like, well, wait a minute, that kind of is there. Talking about the eighth degree earlier, and that was one of the degrees that we did. There's a part or several parts in the third degree where you talk extensively about labor and the importance of labor and how people who oversee, if you have employees, how you should treat those people. And there's talk about the importance of how government is structured and yeah. and the importance of education. Some things that are very central to just a good society. And you know, in the Blue Lodge, what do we teach men? We teach men to be better so that we can have a better society. And so some of these, they're not they're not expounded upon in the Blue Lodge. You may not even realize it's there, but it kind of is. It's just in a much more granular format. And what I think Pike did in some cases is he took that nugget and he just kind of expounded upon it because he had so many more degrees to work with.
When you were talking about one of the degrees the other day to the students, you were talking about men holding a position of responsibility and how that wasn't really theirs to have. It was, they were just occupying that seat for a little mm-hmm. while, so they should have that much respect for it and understand mm-hmm. that, you know, they were ordained with that responsibility, so it was, you know, their duty to carry it out properly. I thought that was just very profound. I was sitting next to Speed when you said that.
I think that we talked about it a little bit. Grand Pontiff degree. I think that's the 19th degree. I'm not sure.
It was pretty cool.
When you got so many degrees, it's hard to remember all the names and the numbers that go with them. But
well, you remembered it.
I have the privilege during the reunions to communicate, to be one of the people who communicates the degrees to the new candidates. And one of the things that I like to do, if we're communicating a degree, that means we're not going to perform it or in a dramatic form. And so as a result, I think, you know, they're getting a synopsis of what the degree is about, but what else is there? And so I like to, even though I'm going to read to you what I'm technically supposed to say, the Supreme Council tells us what we're supposed to say, I like to, like you said, just kind of throw out that little extra nugget. Here's something that strikes me that I think, you know, I at least find interesting and a little bit deeper there. I try to pull that out of each of the degrees when I'm talking about them. You know, one of the things that strikes me too, I talked a little bit about the Lodge of Perfection. From there you go to the Chapter Rose Croix, which ends with the 18th degree, which is the Rose Croix degree, and probably has a much deeper history than even the Blue Lodge, no doubt about that, given some of the symbolism there. But one of the things I really like about it is if you ever decide to join other appendant organizations like the York Rite or the Knight Masons or any of the other AMD kind of things, you will see the 15th and 16th degree time and time again. That story, the rebuilding of the temple, the second temple, is told over and over and over again throughout Freemasonry, throughout the degrees, and it's in the Scottish Rite just like it is in the others. I love that. When you get to the Council of Kadosh, man, that's deep. You got 19 through 30, and every one of them is focused on some different philosophical aspect, from the what we call the lesser mysteries, all the way to the higher mysteries, and it takes historical stories and builds a degree around it to teach a principle or a few sets of principles that men should follow. And that's, of course, I can go on and on about this stuff. I love it. Of course, you know my favorite.
32. Yeah, that's
32 is my favorite.
You know, I don't know. I like 30 and 30. We do 31 especially well at Greensboro. Yeah, 32. They're all special. All of them are special. And even the ones we don't do, you read them and you're just like, man, why aren't we doing this one? Read another one. Why aren't we doing this one? You just can't do them all.
The one I wish we would do at some point in Greensboro, and I'll talk just a second about something where we've been doing a little bit in Greensboro, is the 13th. I would love to see the Royal Arch, which is in the York Rite, but it's done again from a different storyline in the Scottish Rite. I would love to see how that's portrayed. But one of the things we're doing in Greensboro, and I know other valleys, maybe not in North Carolina, but other places are doing similar things. We this summer did a read-through of some of the degrees that we don't normally do to give guys an opportunity, number one, to, at a deeper level, talk about what it is that maybe we're not getting to see, but also to introduce these degrees as potentials for, you know, people to take on and actually do. So if you really like the ideas in this, do you want to take it? Do you want to actually be responsible for making this happen? And then in addition to that, actually doing degrees, no, we're not conferring them, so we don't do the obligations, but actually doing the dramatic form of the degree during the meetings, some of the shorter ones as a program to, again, give guys a taste of what they're not always getting to see. But still, you know, it's there.
I think we do a very good job, certainly at Greensboro, and I assume throughout the state, of the degrees that we don't actually put on, or even the ones that we do put on, of explaining what's in them. You know, you have the explanation that you do, you know, when you're explaining it to them. And then there's the Master Craftsman program, which has been started for, I don't know how many years they've been doing that, less than 10, probably
so,
around
10.
I've done one. I got Master Craftsman 2, and I'm stalled on it. I'm not making any progress. But, boy, there is gold to be mined right there. I mean, and that takes you deep into the degrees. Talk just a little bit about the Master Craftsman program.
When the Master Craftsman program was first introduced, I certainly wasn't the first one to buy into it, but I happened to be, I believe it was down in Mobile, Alabama. I think that's where the leadership conference was when they first put it on sale. And I bought the book, I bought the program, I got through a few of the tests, and it's in a bookshelf now. You know, unfortunately, life happens, and you have all these other things pulling at your time, and that's one of the things that, unfortunately for me, I've had to set aside. I have other interests I follow up on, but that's one I do wish, and it's on my to-do list. It stays there. Eventually, I'm going to get back to it. But, you know, that came out of this idea that we, with the revised, the standard revised pike ritual, we started cutting the degrees down to a manageable time. But what guys really want, and time again, they'll tell you, we want to know more. What is this about? You know, what am I really going to get out of this?
What does it mean?
It was everyone. You, me, all of us, you know, everybody. That we really want, there's a thirst for knowledge. And there was this term, they would say, well, the Scottish Rite is the University of Freemasonry. Well, what does that mean if all you're doing is doing the degrees? Let's give the guys something. There's books, but how about a study program? And the first program that I was aware of was the College of the Consistory out of Guthrie, Oklahoma, another one of those that I started but didn't finish when I found out about it. But the Master Craftsman's program is fairly similar to that, where you it's self-study, you have materials, you refer to those materials, you take tests and do essays, and you learn through introspection, really, which is the way the degrees were intended to be handled. It's good to do it in the dramatic form, but the real meat comes when you're sitting down by yourself with, you know, a drink in your hand and a pen and some paper to take notes as you're reading through what's going on there.
You could spend a lot of time. You could spend years and years and years in the degrees of the Scottish Rite in trying to understand them, and, you know, between morals and dogma and the Master Craftsman program. I mean, there's an entire lifetime of learning hidden in there, isn't there?
There is, and you know, guys like Art DeJoya, the Grand Archivist, the guy must be, I mean, I don't know how big his brain is. Every neuron is being used because he's you know, a ritual fiend, and he knows so much, and how he has been able to pull all this stuff together, you know, and doing some of the updates to the morals and dogma with all the additional notes that he added. We have the resources. In some cases, it's just a matter of getting them into the right hands of the people who need them.
There's been a fair amount of talk in Greensboro about trying to do some sort of study program other than the Master Craftsman, just a group to get together and, you know, talk about the philosophy of the degrees. I'd really like to see us be able to pull that off sometime, and maybe we will. I think they've toyed around with that in Charlotte in years past. I don't know if they still do it or not.
I don't think
you can go wrong getting your brothers together and talking about.
Well, I know they did it.
Masonry.
They did do it in Charlotte for a while. Clayton Wright, as I recall, was heading that up for a number of years. I'm not sure that's still active. My understanding is that they do something similar to that in Raleigh. Ludwig.
In Ludwig.
I believe he's overseeing. I would love to see something like that in Greensboro. Frankly, in every valley, I think, could benefit from that. But I would love to see it in Greensboro. I'd be all over it.
Tell you something else I'd like to see. You know, Gilbert, I told you he texted me the other day and was asking about, you know, us in Charlotte maybe doing something mutually supportive where maybe we, like the way that you explained some of the degrees, come over and explain it to their candidates when they're having their reunion so that Gilbert could be freed up and some of his folks could be freed mm-hmm. up to, you know, actually put on their their reunion. And then he would reciprocate, maybe come over and, you know, Ludwig's not far away, and maybe we could work on being more mutually supportive. You know, we work together pretty good with Winston. I guess it's just because we're geographically pretty close there, I guess. Well, but I'd like to see us all work together more.
Yeah, I would love to. You know, in the past, we've had what we call the Masonic Unity Challenge. Our good friend Larry Thompson, that's how he got involved in the Scottish Rite and the York Rite. It was pretty much, you know, all in one weekend. You get all the York Rite and all the Scottish Rite. And then
wait a minute, I don't know what that is. Tell me what that is. Oh,
you never heard of that?
I never even heard of it.
The Masonic Unity Challenge, I'm not exactly sure when that was. I'm sure Larry could tell us, but maybe 2002, 3, 4, somewhere in that range. They decided across the entire state would do one reunion/festival. And you could take all the York Rite degrees and some number of the Scottish Rite degrees all together, kind of blended. It was done in Winston-Salem, and it was a good time. And from there, a few years after that, two or three years later, we did a statewide reunion down in Charlotte in conjunction with some of the valleys from South Carolina, and we did all 29 degrees. And I'm not sure. I think New Bern may do all 29 degrees still.
Wow. Holy cow.
Once a year. I know Guthrie, Oklahoma does. Most valleys do not. But I know for that particular reunion, they did all the degrees in one long weekend.
Wow. I'd like to see them all. We were talking earlier, we want to go to Guthrie. Guthrie, we're coming for you. Jason Marshall and
yeah.
Bob Davis and... and all that crowd out there.
Jim Trasner. Yeah.
Jim Trasner, yeah. We're coming to out there sometime. Not this year, it doesn't look like.
Larry and I made that threat many a time and just couldn't ever find time on the calendar to make it happen.
Dying to do it. We're gonna make that happen. Mm-hmm. What did we leave out?
Well, on my list, not a whole lot. We talked about Albert Pike a little bit. One thing I would like to just mention about Albert Pike, we talked about morals and dogma. What a lot of people may not know about is his Blue Lodge book, Esoterica.
Yeah.
If you have access to that book, I would highly recommend it as a study guide. Also, if you're not a member of the Scottish Rite Research Society, that is a deal. The Scottish Rite Research Society, one of the foremost research societies in the world. I don't know what the dues are. I was lucky enough to endow fairly early on when it was still pretty cheap. But you get two books a year for whatever that price is, well worth the cost. And I got Esoterica as part of that. So, that's a deal right there.
And one of them's Heredum.
The Heredum is one of the, yeah, so you get the annual Heredum edition.
But you can buy one for like $12, but... if you save them, like number one, volume number one is like insanely expensive. Nobody can find one. I know where there's some lodges with some sitting around I've seen, but
unfortunately,
they don't know what they've got. They need to put them under lock and key.
Yeah, I joined.
Semper Fi.
I joined in time to get number three. So and later I was able to pick up number two. So I have all but number one.
Seems like. I started to say it seems like they would republish it, but, you know, that
but then
it takes away from the allurement, doesn't it?
Yeah,
yeah, it is a good deal, and you always get both your Heredum and a bonus book if you pay on time, and that is a good deal. All right, well, if there's nothing else, I think we're going to roll it up out of here on the Scottish Rite Talk. Brown, you ready to roll us out?
I'm ready.
Let's do it. We'd like to thank Sean for coming. We appreciate you very much, brother.
Thank you. I appreciate you guys.
You're both our friend and our...
Let me just say, shout out to you guys, too, because I love this program. I am a subscriber.
Love it even more now that you're on it.
All right. Thank you for listening to this episode of The Masonian. For more information and productions, please visit us and like our Facebook page at 357 Productions or visit our 357productions.net website. You may also email us at 357productionsteam@gmail.com. Again, that is 357productionsteam@gmail.com. As always, tell people that you love them. And remember, we meet on the level and part on the square.